Happy Easter. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. I'm excited to start this morning with a responsive reading. It's from number 612 in the back of the hymnal. I will read the non-bolded portion, and you'll respond with the bold. He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee.
Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days."
He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee.
From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and on the third day be raised to life.
He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee.
And when they came together in Galilee, he said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and on the third day he will be raised to life."
He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee.
We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death, and will turn him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. On the third day, he will be raised to life.
He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke unto you when he was yet in Galilee.
And Jesus told them, "This very night you will all fall away on account of me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee."
Then they remembered his words. Thank you. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you. There are no words to thank you for what today means. The day that your Son rose from the dead, defeated death forever, and took with him all of our sins, past and present, that are forever forgiven. We thank you for such an incredible gift. We're excited to celebrate that this morning, and I pray that as we go throughout this entire week, we just keep in mind and remember the incredible sacrifice of your Son and the incredible victory that's had on this day. We love you, Lord, and we pray your blessing on this service, on this Resurrection Sunday. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
I'm alive. tomb, they saw a young man in a white robe standing on the right side of the tomb, and they were alarmed. "Do not be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. Come see the place where they have laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you."
Thank you. you cut off the first part of my lead-in. It's okay. We'll start over.
I've got a new name, a new name. it's been quite a week, hasn't it?
I just want to say thank you to everyone who participated with all the different activities this week, from funeral preparations and all of that to Good Friday services and then Sunday. Did you get enough to eat at the brunch?
Whoa.
And I saw a bunch of Revelation Point people scarfing food over there. And that was nice. It was kind of a last minute invite, and it looks like they had a few dozen going over there. And all good stuff. And Noemi, we're so grateful for her help, and the ladies in the kitchen. Yeah, we're grateful. So thank you for that. Thank you for being here today. And Easter. So Jennifer and I, a few months ago, went to a funeral, and I told you about this funeral. It was a gentleman in his 90s. It was a father of one of our friends that was in our wedding, and friends from years gone by. And he was a gentleman, came to Christ in his early 30s, kind of had a rough go, and came to Christ, and hard-working gentleman, mechanic and taxi cab driver, and served the Lord in so many different ways. But he had a sense of humor. So this was the funeral. We went to wonderful service, you know, everything went well. And at the end, they played the song, Don't Worry, Be Happy. Which I thought, you know, it's human, and it's so funny, and it's appropriate, because don't worry, be happy. He's with Jesus, you know, and his wife had gone before him. But in that service as well, they told a story. Because I guess he was a jokester. And he had served in World War II. He had been in the European theater and with tanks, a tank mechanic. Eventually got, I don't know if he drove or led some tanks in the war. And it was, you know, pretty amazing stories. I guess they found some medals. And he also served in Korea to some extent, which is pretty neat. And I didn't know that. Well, he's a jokester, right? Many years later, Pershing Golf starts. So he got a friend who got somehow created an official looking document from the United States government, sent to his house, saying that he was being drafted back into the military service at 70. And I don't know, the documentation, it was just, I don't know how they did it, but it was perfect. And if he knew his wife, woo! You know, she was that type of a personality. And he didn't tell her for, I think, a week. And finally told her, no, I know, it was a joke on you. Yeah, I don't know if they needed counseling or what after that, or if he slept in the garage for a while. That was pretty good. I don't think I'd have it in me to do anything quite like that, because I know I'd be eating Kentucky Fried Chicken a whole bunch after that. We've seen a lot, even especially the last months. War's no fun, is it? And life has its challenges, and there's a lot of wars, and though we make light of some things, there's something they're just not light of. And war and death and dying. And that's what Resurrection Sunday is all about, isn't it? We've spent the last 7 weeks preparing for today. And we've taken Holy Week, Triumphal Entry, and every Sunday we've taken one of those weeks in preparation for today. And today is Resurrection Sunday, which we just... And if you look at it from heaven, as it were, an eternal perspective, this is the centralic, most important event in all of time, space, and place. It's the pivotal point of resurrection. That's significant. Not only did we receive forgiveness, but, you know, this whole thing that now, you know, he's taken back the world and preparing for his kingdom to come in totality, of which he will return someday. Amen. So as we go through this, this road to Calvary, I want to spend some time today just look at some resurrection guarantees. Now there are many, many more. I didn't think you wanted to be here till 1 or 2 this afternoon. Some of you, I hear there's something about Easter lunches at home, you know. That's the last thing I want to do is get moms and parents all upset about that. But, so I've narrowed it down to five. We may get some more down the road. The significance of the cross. Please allow me more of an academic thing, because have you ever read the Gospels and went, well, that happened, but it doesn't mention it here, and all the sequence. So just, you've got it in front of you. This is just academic, but recognize that all these appearances of Christ before he was ascended up into heaven. So on Easter morning, Resurrection Sunday, these things were here, the empty tomb, Mary Magdalene, other women that is recorded, the two people going to Emmaus, or the road to Emmaus. That is a unique story, isn't it? You know, these two, and then for them to come back. So that's there to Peter. Then there's 10 in the upper room, and minus who was called the doubter? Tommy Boy, yeah. Yeah, and so the week later, the following Sunday, Thomas comes up and Jesus says, see and touch. Then the seven disciples fishing on the mountain. Now, I actually read this morning in my old reading through the scriptures. In Corinthians, it says more than 500 people witnessed him. Now, I don't know where and how and whatever, but in the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Paul of the church at Corinth. Now, that's a lot of witness, right? Testimony that he was alive. To James, Corinthians, to his disciples, Mount of Olives, where he ascends. And then last but not least, our dear friend Paul, who would later come to conversion on the Damascus Road, and he would see Christ. Because one of the qualifications of being an apostle was that you had to visually see Christ. I mean, that seemed to be one of the quintessential elements of being an apostle. And that's why you don't have any apostles, as it were, anymore. So that, I just thought you'd like to have that refrigerator art with some of the information that maybe would help kind of put that together. The first thing, Jesus is Lord. So some of the guarantees, some of the promise, some of the results that Jesus is Lord. Read with me Romans chapter 1 and verse 4. Is it declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. So the resurrection guaranteed and proved deity, divinity of Christ. It proved his power. It proved his authority. Now, we love superhero movies, don't we? That's been a big thing the last few years, especially, I mean, I even grew up with comic books and superheroes. We all like, there is nobody like Christ. He is God in flesh, died and came back to life. And he proved that. And it says that in Matthew chapter 28, as he's beginning to, going to ascend, go back to the Father, it says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. And as a result, go make disciples. So he took back lost ground, as it were, because of a sinful world. And then Philippians, it said, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So this aspect of him, Jesus is Lord, this the resurrection confirmed that he was who he said he was, that he did what he said he was going to do, and only affirms in our mind that when he says he's going to return, he's going to return, right? And all his glory, it's an exciting thing to see him like that. We think in special ways of that and look forward to it. The second thing, a living hope. So the word in the New Testament, hope, elpis, it's not like, I hope the Tigers win someday, somehow. Lions and Tigers and Cats, oh my, you know. Or, I hope this takes place, I hope. Yeah. The New Testament word for hope is not if, it's just a matter of when. Right? So, we have a living hope in Christ because of his resurrection. We'll read a scripture in a moment. This is just hot off the press. I enjoy World Magazine. It's kind of a Christian Times. It's very good. And this, I just got this yesterday. And this is the Ukrainian, and it says, "We need victory." Ukrainian carrying caskets, refugees crying, her home all smashed up. We're, you know, pictures that you've seen, you and I have seen on the news, and it's breaking our heart to see what's going on. It's pretty amazing what they are doing. And I don't know all what God's up to, but it's pretty special. But talk about hope, huh? If we ask this hope, we pray for them, there's no guarantee that they're going to win, although it's looking pretty good in some ways and others. But we have a hope that's secure. I mean, it's just a guarantee. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Let's read what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1. "According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance undefiled and unfading, kept in heaven for you." Isn't that a phenomenal concept of hope? I think this area of hope we need to plug into every once in a while, don't we? That's a key area the enemy wants to go, just like he did from the beginning. Really? Did God really? Is he going to? What if he lets them just one time makes this mistake, or you're unworthy of it, or all those lies and those fears and doubts that we're so good at picking up at? We have a living hope, and it's because of the resurrection. And he is who he said, and he proved it, and he's coming back. Even through all the challenges of life. Anybody have any challenges?
Amen.
Yeah. Get in line, right? But we have something different. Even though we're with Peter and the disciples in the boat, and it's kind of rocky, and the winds, the waves, and we can't even see shore, and we've been battling it for hours. There's hope, and he's there, and he's working, and all we have to do is keep watching and keep listening, and it's eternal, and it's not only this side of heaven, but one day when we get to see him, huh? All of that will be put behind us, and we will see, and our faith will be complete, and our hope will, it's kind of like the icing on the cake, right? Shouldn't talk about food anymore. You guys are doing so far good. I was a little worried that I'm going to have to have a seventh inning stretch in the middle of this, all that good food that we ate. But so far, so good. But hang tight. I may have to stand up and do the wave or something like that. Christ's intercession. Now, this may come as a surprise to you, but people are fickle. Did you know that?
No.
Not anybody here. Talk about people being fickle, people being inconsistent, people being, even with the best intentions, how disappointing, how frustrating, how whatever, life. Like in this Passion Week, and especially for Saturday, Friday and Saturday and Sunday, how Christ dealt with those that struggled and just messed up. It's just an amazing thing of grace. Especially when you read in a moment with his intercession, his interceding on our behalf. Because we're not used to people being consistent and straight and love never waning or ceasing. How he dealt with Thomas. Yo, Tom. Until I see, and I want some empirical evidence. Yo, Tom. Peter. Love him. Nobody else stepped out. Nobody else went as far as he did. Messed up big time. And yet, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Yo, Pete. Because I love you. Now, get to work. I think that's pretty phenomenal. Let alone all the disciples that split dissimo. I mean, they just took off when he got arrested. Scared, Steph? You and I probably do the same thing. How he dealt with it. This is amazing. Now, and he intercedes. He cares. In fact, he even prayed. You remember that when he predicted that Peter was going to deny him? He said, I prayed for you that your faith would be strong. Not just for you, but those following you. Incredible insight. Let's read. But it says in Romans, a great chapter, Romans 8, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. That word intercede, going between, almost a legal aspect. It's kind of like when there's an accusation, and you did this, and he's right there in between, and maybe we did. You think about that. It's like in the Old Testament with the prophet, and Satan was pointing fingers at the prophet. Of course, he had dirty clothes, remember that? And he had an advocate, somebody interceding or praying on our behalf. This is a great chapter, Romans chapter 8. It goes on earlier in that chapter. It says, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing. Zip, nada, nothing. Think about that. There's a lot of things that could separate us, you know, from love of a lot of people, because we're just as fickle as anybody else. Think about that as he defends us as his kids, even when we're prodigals. And he mediates for us, even like an attorney kind of thing. Talk about steadfast love. You ever have that with a family member that, I love you, but I don't like you much now. You know, and you're working on that. You know? Think about that. He forgives us. He doesn't treat us as our sins deserve, the scriptures say. He's patient. Don't you just love patience? Give me patience now. Just think of them. Maybe there's a billion Christians. They throw that out there, and that may be a loose figure. Just think about God the Father putting all of us up in one day. How frustrating that would be with all those, even if our best intentions don't live up to the name of Christ. And yet he loves and forgives us. He's patient. And there's just so many things that we could say. He intercedes. That's because of the resurrection, he's at the right hand of God the Father, directly interceding for us on our behalf. And we may be guilty of whatever is the condemnation or whatever. And he says, but my blood covers completely. And not like we humans, God, you know, we don't have a concept of forgetting. God can't forget, but he forgets. As far as the east is from the west, as deep as part of the sea, it is not held against us. Amen. Another one of the guarantees is his judgment. Now you probably kind of go, let me. I had some new thoughts. Ooh, did you hear the earth shake a little bit? So first of all, Jennifer went to a seminar this week. One of her kids won some merit scholarly with the Marriott appearance and something there, and they had a speaker, wrote some books. And I remember some of the conversations she brought back. And this speaker, just, you know, in school systems and all around the world, and we're you know, in an entitlement era. But even further than that, and some of the surveys this person did, and it wasn't just schools and all, in every place, the aspect of people just rejecting authority, in a sense. That this person gave a testimony how this kid, I guess, was in school or something like that. The teacher instructed them not to do this, whatever it was. And this person said, you can't tell me to do that. Am I a dog? You can't tell me that. I don't have to obey you. Wow. Now, maybe we've all done that from time to time to God or to somebody else. But here's the background. What makes us significant? So This is kind of lights were going off this week for me. Just think if Christ never came to earth and never went to the cross and never rose again. Same old, same old. There would be no forgiveness. There would be nothing changed. There would not be a new life in Christ and salvation. There would be no justice. There's no end game. Life would just roll on miserably, spinning down out of control. But because of the resurrection, as Corinthians say, he victory and broke the sin and death. Now he can change things. And from this miserable, wonderful world he created, but affected by sin, slowly just going down, 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 down. Stop. And then we'll have a point of accountability and he will judge. This is an incredible thing. So it says in the book of Acts together, let's read. Because he has fixed the day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is huge. I don't really like the idea of being judged per se, but for the believer in Christ, it's not whether you're in or out. It's like, show your works, there's going to be rewards. And for the Stalins and the Mussolinis and the Hitlers and maybe the Putins and whatever, justice will be served. And it wouldn't have been if he didn't come back from the dead. That's huge. So yeah, I think that's a neat thing that resurrection guarantees judgment, because if not, it would continue to spin out of control. And we would just be caught in the tsunami of life and sin, and just be one more person living and dying with no hope and nothing to look forward to, no judgment or no reward for the believer, huh? We're working diligently, want to serve faithfully, and hear thou well done, thou good and faithful servant. That's, I think, rather significant. The last one we're going to look at today is resurrection assurance. And let's read what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and 14, kind of right in the middle of the sentence there. Knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with him into his presence. Because of he raised Christ, this is the assurance, and there's other verses that we talk about assurance of the believer and the faithfulness of the Lord. But this is rather significant. Jesus earlier said, you know, I am the resurrection and the life, and that he believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. There's an interesting story I read the other day. Sergeant John Peck was an American Marine who lost all four limbs in an explosion in Afghanistan in 2010. At first, he thought he'd spend the rest of his life wearing prosthesis arms and legs. But I can hardly believe this, in 2016, he received a double arm transplant. The limbs came from a young man who was declared brain dead and whose arms were rushed and packed ice to an operating room in Boston for a 14-hour transplant surgery, performed by a team of 60 surgeons, nurses, and technicians. And when Peck woke up the next day, he had somebody else's arms. And today, John Peck is able to perform many daily tasks with his new arms, including signing copies of his book, Rebuilding Sergeant Peck. If human medical technology can do so much to help our bodies recover from horrific tragedies, imagine what God can do instantaneously at the moment of resurrection. We will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Wow. So, the resurrection assurance comes with it, this aspect of glorification of the body. All the isms of life. That old classic hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born in his spirit, washed in his blood. Won't that be something when all of our limbs and heads and bodies are all functioning well, better than they ever have? That's incredible. So that's because of the resurrection and the assurance that we have that we'll be there in Christ. And as you want to read a great chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 talks about the glorified body in heaven. It's just going to be phenomenal. And hopefully we'll eat in heaven too. Probably pizza and ice cream and chocolate.
Amen.
Don't quote me on that. So last night, Jennifer and I were kind of catching our breath. It's been quite the week. I always thought, you know, I was trying to get some ideas and, you know, Jennifer, what do you think of resurrection? I'll tell you the story, you'll understand why she just kind of, you know, what's so significant about resurrection? Well, our week started out with Dad in a fall on Monday, where it could have been much worse, but significant. Arm very sore, found out the next day it was dislocated. So we ended up going to his primary care, who sent us to urgent care, who sent us to an emergency center where they had to sedate him. So here I am taking my dad around and they're laying down. Finally they sedated him, got it in place, strapped for the next 2-3 weeks with this sling, and then taking him back home and getting in and out with one arm. Lord, what are we going to do with that? And then we had Bunny's funeral, and thank you for everybody that was involved, and it's just wonderful, and the food and the presentation, and yet, you know, we lost another good one. Yeah? Pillar of the assembly, as it were. Lord, this is a tough life. In the meantime, Dad at 2 a.m. was having palpitations, and we got calls, and he's okay. The EM unit came, but didn't take him in, so Jeff stayed over there. He spent the last couple of nights, because I was kind of busy. Lord, what do we do? We'll help our dad, who we love and respect, but he can't be by himself. So it's Friday morning, and we're going, Jeff spent all night, and this isn't going to work. We got to do something. And, you know, by God's grace, I was on the phone, and within hours, God had found a place of respite care for a couple of weeks, more or less, whatever, just to kind of rehabilitate and get him to help and care. And that's a miracle of God that it happened so quickly, bing, bang, boom. And so we had a Good Friday service, which was wonderful, and would join with Revelation Point, but that was kind of a big thing too this week. And then on Saturday, Jeff, myself, and family, you know, now went to Dad and packed up a whole bunch of stuff and drove to Green Acres in Lowell, which I had been there before. That's what Dick Cooper had been. Nice, nice place. Worked with them, got them in. And so that was a little bit packed, you know. Maybe you've been there, but it's tough to watch one you love and going down, you know what I mean? And hopefully he'll get some strength and to leave, and now leave him being by himself in a place like that, new, you know, but good help. And so I hope all's going well. We'll visit him today. Hopefully he behaves. He will. And so, yeah, at the end of that day, Jennifer, what do you think about resurrection? But you know what? No disrespect. I mean, we were just whipped last night. We physically, chairs, TVs, and loaded up and moved back and forth and physically tired, and then had to ramp up for the day. But you know what? It's all about resurrection. Because that's not going to happen in the future. All the challenges, people, health,
the issues of life got to be gone because of the resurrection. Isn't that exciting? And that's the hope that we share in Christ in the future. And though they may not go away right away, and, you know, they're still day by day and with each passing moment, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, we trust because God's working. And you can identify, and I'm not much different than the rest of you, is life. But I think with Revelation chapter 21 and verse 5, I'm going to turn there for a second. We've mentioned it before, especially when we went through eschatology and end times. When the Lord Jesus Christ, chapter 21, verse 5, and he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Wow. That's what it's all about. Because if he didn't, we'd still be in a downward spiral, going further and further and further and further and further down to nothing. So we have challenges. Oh yeah, God, give us strength. I'll probably sleep very well tonight. And yet, God gives strength, he gives guidance and provision, and it's because he's Lord. We have hope. He is interceding for us in the right hand of God the Father. He is going to judge and he will reward and he's going to make everything right. And we have assurances, especially if we come to him in faith and trust him and respond to his saving grace that I am in need. I confess my sins. I accept the work of the cross. Forgive me of my sins and allow me to be one of your children. Or maybe come back. You've been around the block a couple of times. Time to come home. Come back to the fold. God is faithful. And we trust him. Because behold, I'm making all things. Now let's start it again. Behold, I am making all things new. Amen? Close in prayer in the room. I'd like to sing Solid Rock 340. So, gracious Father, thank you as we come today to worship. We have been blessed with incredible food and fellowship and worship and different musical presentations and expressions of scripture and promises from your word, and been reminded once again of that resurrection, but of great significance. And we have great assurance because of that. So Lord, today, every person here has their burdens. Every person here has their challenges, struggles. Lord, may we just give them to you, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Lord, may we make sure that you're on the throne of our lives. And may we just enjoy peace and satisfaction, even in the midst of challenges, that we would learn to be content and grateful. But we thank you because there's an empty tomb today, and there's a Lord, our Lord is in the right hand of God the Father, interceding for us daily. So we thank you. Bless in Jesus' name. Amen. 340, please.
Solid rock, I stand on.
blessings.